Hello everyone. Hi, welcome to the channel of Wall Street Mojo. Watch the video till the end, and if you're new to this channel, then you can subscribe us by clicking the bell icon. Friends, today we are going to learn a tutorial on debt covenants, bond covenant, and some of the examples, some of the advantages and disadvantages of the same. At the very first inception thing, you know, what you can see over here is that in simple words, debt covenants are the restrictions, very important, imposed by the lenders, which are your investors or creditors, on the borrowers of the company or the debtors. So, what exactly is debt covenants? As from the definition, you know, debt covenants are the restrictions imposed by the lenders on the borrowers. So, ideally, when the lenders lend the money to the borrowers, they sign an agreement. So, and under these agreement, the borrower have to maintain certain restriction so that the interest on the lender is basically protected. This is an example over here that how the agreement, you know, this is an extract from the agreement that how things may work out. See, it's shown that the net interest bearing debt to total asset does not exceed 0.65. The net secured debt to total asset does not exceed 0.55. And the ratio of the adjusted profit before taxes on the total interest expense exceeds 1.40. So this are all, this is the basically debt covenants or the bond covenants can be called in many names. Two of the most popular names are banking covenants and the financial covenants. Actually, they all mean the same thing. So my next question, I'm going to ask you questions and you are going to try and figure out why are debt covenants necessary, very important. In other words, you can say why bond covenants lenders would restrict the borrowers from doing something. The bond covenants lenders don't want to pressurize the borrowers with the rules and restrictions. However, if they don't bind the borrowers with few terms or condition, they may not get their money back. Exactly, that's the point. So it is also very important to notice that, you know, the debt covenants also helps the borrower, yes, even after being restricted. And when the agreement between the borrowers and the lenders is signed, the terms and condition, you have every time you see this TNC, terms and condition are discussed. And if the borrower abide by the terms, they may need to pay a lower interest rate. That is basically the cost of borrowing to the lenders. Let's take some of the examples so that you may get a clear idea of what we are talking about. So let's get into the example. Let's say that Icebreaker, there's this company called Icebreaker and Company. Let's say it has taken a debt or a loan from a bank, and the bank has offered a company a loan of, let's say, around 1 million. This is in millions. Okay, this is $1 million loan, stating that until the company pays off the bank, the principal plus interest of 10%, the company won't be able to take any additional loan from the market. Now, the restriction that is over here that has been imposed by the bank on the Icebreaker company would be called as the bond covenant. Right? But why the bank would do such a thing? Let's analyze it. First of all, the banks would do it on its own due diligence before lending the amount to the Icebreaker company. Second, if the bank finds that the Icebreaker company does not have a good risk profile, lending amount would be risky for a bank. And in this case, if the company goes out and also borrows a million here and another million there and goes belly up, the bank will not get its money back. I mean, the bank will not get back its money in totality cases. Thinking about the future, the bank may restrict the company from borrowing any additional loan until the loan of the bank is being paid off in full. Now, let's understand the next thing, that is the metrics, the bond covenants metrics. How do lenders get to know what bond covenants they need to impose upon the borrower? So here are some of the metrics that the lenders and borrower needs to look at before imposing the bond covenants. The first thing is the total assets. Now, a company that has a good enough AUM, remember this word AUM, asset under management, would have good financial health, at least on the surface. So to know whether a company can pay off its debt, the lenders need to look at the next ratio. Second, the debt to the assets ratio. Now, this is simple ratio that every lender needs to look at before lending any money to the borrower. And this ratio basically helps to the investor understand whether the company has enough assets to pay off its debts. Like, for example, if they have lower total assets than the debts, then the company may have lent into a big problem. Or else, if the company has a pretty low debt, that is, let's say that is 10% of the total assets, the company will be playing too safe. Third, the debt divided by the equity. That's the next metric. Even if the equity shareholders would get paid off after the debt holders would get the money, still it's important for the investor to know the debt equity ratio of the company. By looking at the ratio, they would be able to see how much debt and how much equity the company has taken and what's the risk of the debt holder to lose out. Fourth, this is really, I consider this as a really good ratio, debt to EBITDA ratio. EBITDA is preferred over EBIT. This is one of the most important metric the lenders should look at. Since EBITDA is basically earning before interest, tax, depreciation and amortization and can really show whether the company has the financial stability to pay off its debt, which includes not only the interest, but the principal plus interest in the due time. Fifth, the interest coverage ratio. Now, this is another measure that is so very important, that interest coverage ratio compares the EBIT by EBITDA with the interest. So, higher the ratio, you can say, higher the ratio is would be better for the lenders. And if the ratio is lower, then the lenders may need to think about the offering a loan to the company. The sixth metric is the dividend DP ratio, dividend payout ratio. Now, why is this ratio even important? It's because the dividend payout ratio decides how much a dividend the company would declare at the end of the year. So, if the dividend payout is too high, it may enhance the risk of the lenders. And that's why one of the most common debt covenant is restricting the borrowers from paying the huge dividend. Now, there is a thing called positive covenant and there is a thing called negative covenant. So, let's understand each of them. Positive debt covenant are the thing that a borrower must do to ensure that they get the loan. Below, like, you know, positive covenants are like, you know, they aim at a specific range of certain financial ratios. Like, positive debt covenant is very important for the lenders to know that they are protected, to ensure that the lenders may ask for the borrower to reach a specific range for a certain financial ratio to avail the loan. Second, basically to ensure the accounting practices are as per the GAAP. Now, this is the basic ask, but an important one. The lenders must ensure that the borrowers are adhering to the generally accepted accounting principle. The third is present yearly audited financial statement. A positive debt covenant lenders must ensure whether the financial statement are accurate and represents the right picture of the company's financial affairs. And that's why a yearly audit will definitely help. Now let's discuss the negative debt covenants. The negative debt covenants are the things the borrower cannot do, below which the things cannot be done. Like, you know, the first one, this is on the example, don't pay cash dividend over a certain, you can say, extent. So if a firm gives away the majority of its earning in cash dividend, how would it pay off the money they owe to the lenders? And that's why the lenders impose a restriction on the borrowers that they cannot pay cash dividend over the certain extent. Second, don't take any additional loan. So the negative debt covenant is borrowers should not take more loans before they pay off the due to the lenders, and it helps to protect the interest of the lenders. And don't sell specific assets. Negative debt covenants, lenders may also restrict the borrowers from selling certain assets until the debt is being paid full. So doing so will compel the borrowers to generate more earnings to pay off the debts. So the negative debt covenants will protect both the lenders and the borrowers in the long run. If you have learned and, you know, liked the video, If you think that, you know, if you have enjoyed and learned watching this video, please like, comment on this video and subscribe to our channel for all the latest updates. Thank you, everyone. Cheers.